my Toronto. VK on the beat, check. I'm in Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. I'm from Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. I'm in Toronto, like you wanna get the city love. My city love me back.
Welcome to episode 1057 of Toronto Mic'd, proudly brought to you by Great Lakes Brewery, a fiercely independent craft brewery who believes in supporting communities, good times, and brewing amazing beer. Order online for free local home delivery in the GTA. StickerU.com. Create custom stickers, labels, tattoos, and decals for your home and your business. Palma Pasta. Enjoy the taste of fresh, homemade Italian pasta and entrees from Palma Pasta in Mississauga and Oakville. Doer. The world's most comfortable pants and shorts. Save 15% with the promo code TMDS. Ridley Funeral Home. Pillars of the community since 1921. And Canna Cabana, the lowest prices on cannabis guaranteed. Over 100 stores across the country. Learn more at cannacabana.com. Joining me this week, making his Toronto Mic debut, is Torquil Campbell from Stars. May I call you Torque?
You may, you must.
It's funny because I had Michael Barclay in my backyard the other day. Do you know Michael?
Yes, I do indeed. I love Michael. He's just wrote a great book.
He did, and you're...
About some great bands.
He wrote a chapter called Your Ex-Lover is in the Band.
Yes, he found some things out.
And that might be the greatest chapter title he's got, but I will just shout out his new book. Do you know the name of his book? All I've been calling it is the Michael
Hearts on Fire.
Hearts on Fire.
Okay. Yeah.
So if anybody is at all interested in the great Canadian music we put out from 2000 to 2005, check out Michael Barclay's new book.
But he wrote a great book about the hip, too.
Yeah. The Never-Ending Present. Every time he writes a book, I make him come over and we talk about it. So
he's a fascinating guy. I had him on my podcast, actually.
Okay, what's your podcast called?
My podcast is called Soft Revolution. And me and my buddy Ali Moman host it.
Well, he knows his stuff. So if Barclay's on there, people got to check that out for
sure. That's right. That's right.
But
we only get the best.
Because your first name is, I don't know any other, again, I like the name Torque, but Torquil, right? Because
Torquil.
Yeah, Torquil. Is it a common name anywhere? I'm trying to think if I know any.
No, it is not a common name anywhere. There's an actor in Newfoundland called Torquil Colbo.
Okay.
And the Duke of Argyll is called Torquil Campbell. It's sort of like naming your son like Chauncey or... Brooklyn. Like, it's for like nouveau riche assholes. And my father was a dirt poor Glaswegian. So I have no idea why he decided to call me Torquil. I think he was trying to get me, you know, up in the social standings.
It's almost pretentious, right? That's why Torque is better.
It's almost pretentious. It's well beyond pretentious. It's ridiculous.
But
it sounds like a character in a fairy tale or something.
Awfully like la-di-da for a guy who appeared in Strange Brew.
Yeah, I know. It doesn't track with my dad at all, except that it means son of thunder.
Okay.
And he was somewhat thunderous. So maybe he was paying himself a compliment there.
Okay, so before I get back to Barclay, and there's another FOTM who wants me to shout you out, but your dad's name, Douglas Campbell, a pretty accomplished actor. I was looking at his IMDb page. I shouted out Strange Brew because I love Strange Brew, and I just had Dave Thomas on the show. But tell me a little bit about your dad.
Oh, man. I've been thinking a lot about my dad lately, actually. I'm not sure why he left us about 12 years ago. He was an extraordinary person. He was a socialist, a pacifist, a vegetarian, and an actor. And those four principles led him through his life. And he came from a very poor part of Glasgow and sort of taught himself how to speak like a posh English person. And married the daughter of a couple of very famous actors in England called Lewis Casson and Sybil Thorndike, and went on to, you know, was playing Othello at the Old Vic in the West End, like 2 years after he started being an actor. He was a conscientious objector in the Second World War. So he was one of the few men around who was, and he had a trucker's license. So he got hired by an acting company. Okay. And then he went on to Stratford and founded the Stratford Festival with Tyrone Guthrie, and then worked there for many, many years, and was on Broadway and the West End, and starred in a TV show called The Great Detective for a long time on CBC, and was just an amazing drinking buddy and irreverent rebel and lovey. I adored him. He was great.
Well, I know it's 12 years, but I am very sorry for your loss.
Thanks, man. You know, it's weird because you forget sometimes, like you don't think about them for a while. And then lately I've been thinking a lot about him, and I don't know, maybe that's because his ghost is nearby, or maybe it's because I'm getting older. I'm the age he was when I was born. So maybe that's given me some time to think about it. But he was a guy that a lot of people, we had 3 funerals for him. There was just, we had to have a funeral in Vancouver, a funeral in Montreal, and a funeral in Toronto. And he just touched a lot of people's lives. He was the kind of guy you could go over, he'd give you something to eat, he'd lend you $100, he'd tell you honestly who you were, and he'd send you on your way.
Now, you know, I mentioned an actor, as you did, and you know, you did some acting yourself. So we're going to get back to all this, but right off the top, Decisive says that he loves you. He goes, I love him. Oh. Derek Christoph, Decisive, recently came over here and just basically sat here. I know you're remote here. Whereabouts are you in the world right now?
I'm at our jam space in Montreal. I'm at Mount Zoomer. We just finished rehearsal.
Okay, so you've got a good excuse for not being here physically. You're not in in the hood. But but Decisive came over and he just, you know, just let it out, man. He just was complete real talk. He talked about his struggles the last several years. And what can you say? How do you know Decisive?
I don't think I've met him. I might have met him once, but I admire him a lot. I think he's a great rapper, and I think he's a very honest artist and a very vulnerable artist. And I love people who can tweak the kind of model of hip hop and make it something like Kendrick does, and like Decisive does, and like Andre 3000 does. And a lot of people, Pasta Noose, do that. Rap is a great form for reflection. It's not just a great place to boast. It's a great place to be honest as well. And Decisive is amazing at honesty.
Well, he's a storyteller, much like yourself, right? And he's a storyteller, and he you know, he speaks from the heart, and he writes from the heart, and I think that's why we all love this guy.
I agree. I think he's great. He's fantastic.
So I thread in.
I meet him one day.
Well, listen,
I don't know
next
why
time
we
you're
haven't met.
Next time you're hanging around Toronto,
should do a song together. That's what we should do.
Well, listen, I'll broker that deal. Meaning, I'll just we'll all get together. I would love it, man. That'd be cool.
That would be great.
Now, I threatened to come back to Michael Barclay. So I'm coming back because he knew you were coming on today and he sent me a little note. He says, be sure to ask him about Platinum Blonde at Nathan Phillips Square for Toronto's sesquicentennial. And I happen to know our sesquicentennial was 1984 because I was playing softball at Rennie Park and our team in 1984 was nicknamed the Sesquies. It was the only year there was a team called the Sesquies, and I was on the Sesquies. So I'll never forget, 1984. Tell me about this Platinum Blonde show.
Well, for some reason, they made a big deal out of the sesquicentennial. I mean, that was back in the day when in Toronto, it was like one reason a year for people to go out after 6 o'clock. You know, it was not popping. So everybody was making a big fuss about sesquicentennial. Charlie Spearin, who is in Broken Social Scene and Do Make Say Think and has worked with all kinds of amazing people and is probably, I don't know, he's in the top 3 musicians I've ever met in my life in terms of his skills and abilities. I have been friends with Charlie since we were 8 years old. And the first gig I ever saw was Platinum Blonde at Nathan Phillips Square, because that's how Charlie celebrated his 12th birthday. It was by taking us all
amazing
to see Platinum Blonde. It was a free show. It was a good thing to do with a bunch of kids. You didn't have to pay for them. It was cheaper than bowling, you know. And Charlie even then was like, Charlie looked amazing when he was 12. He had like swept back Elvis hair, and he was taller than all of us, and he wore cool clothes, and he was already way ahead of us. He was already a complete cool
So okay, so you're at this time you're in Toronto. I just wanted to recollect with you here. Like, were you at all listening to any CFTR at this time? Any top 40? You there? Oh, you froze up. Okay, so if you're watching on the live stream, Torque has frozen up, and we're gonna wait to get him back here. I gotta find out if he was listening to Situation Critical. This is where I can pipe in the Platinum Blonde while we wait for him to reconnect. Hey, maybe since I'm recording this and to save me an edit, I want to thank the sponsors real quick here. So, Palma Pasta, go to palmapasta.com. That's delicious, authentic Italian food. And they're in Mississauga and Oakville. And Great Lakes Brewery, delicious fresh craft beer. He'll be back. That's an internet or maybe a power outage or something in Montreal. And Torque has left us. But when Torque gets back, he's going to wish he was here in Toronto where I could give him some GLB fresh craft beer. Go to greatlakesbeer.com. And again, free delivery in the GTA. StickerU.com. StickerU.com. YOU. Upload your image and then order your stickers and your decals and your temporary tattoos and everything. Badges. It's amazing. Those guys make amazing products. I have stickers that are now, several years old, and they're still like pristine condition. This is quality stuff. Speaking of quality stuff, Duer pants, D-U-E-R, rugged, comfortable. I can bike in them. I can roll into the boardroom in them. The world's most comfortable pants. Go to Duer.ca. Use the promo code TMDS. Or you can go to the retail store. They have a retail store on Queen Street. And you can use the promo code TMDS and save 15%. Shout out to Ridley Funeral. I almost went when we were opening up talking about Douglas. That's Torque's dad. He's passed away 12 years ago. I almost said shout out to Ridley Funeral Home, but I'm like, no, this is too personal. Hold on to that. But I will say now, shout out to Ridley Funeral Home. Brad at Ridley Funeral Home has an amazing podcast called Life's Undertaking. And you can subscribe and listen wherever you get your podcasts, even right here. One more sponsor, but I'm going to talk to Torque about this company later because Torque is a big fan of cannabis. And if you're a fan of cannabis, regardless of how you consume cannabis, you need to be buying your cannabis at Canna Cabana. They will not be undersold on cannabis or cannabis accessories. Go to cannacabana.com and buy your weed from people who love weed and know weed. I know Torque loves weed and he knows his weed, but now we have a technical problem. So if you're on the live stream, bear with me. I'm going to see if I have a note from Torque telling me he's lost power and cannot connect. Was it something I said? Okay, so I'm going to patiently wait for the bell. I sincerely thought about playing some Platinum Blonde for Torque, but I'm like, I have some Stars songs I want to play. But while we wait, wonder what this will get us booted from the live stream, but let's see what happens here. Typically, in my experience, so I've got my text here. Is that Torque? Let's see here. That's my daughter, everybody, texting me just to tease me here. Okay, so we'll get back to that. My daughter's amazing. So we just learned that Torque is in Montreal. And my daughter's going to be living in Montreal next year. So I will have ample opportunity.
Are you sitting comfortably? Then we'll begin.
Dedicating some Platinum Blonde to Torque. We're going to have a great chat. Assuming he returns. It's all part of the fun, part of the adventure here. Yeah, I can shout out the O Cannabis Conference and Expo, which is happening this week, because I'm moderating a panel there. So if you're going to the O Cannabis Conference at the International Center. Track me down and say hi. I'll be there Friday. There were two back-to-back, so I was a big Platinum Blonde guy. I used to buy Hostess potato chips, and I had the little cards in there for the bands of the time, like Corey Hart, Bryan Adams, a lot of cool bands, Glass Tiger, and of course, Platinum Blonde. And this song was a big hit on CFTR for me, Crying Over You. And then the follow-up was, I want to say, and I hope this is going by memory, so it's several decades ago, right? That was like mid-80s, but Situation Critical was like the next song. And I remember I would hear Situation Critical, and then in my mind I would map it. Here comes Torque. I would map it to this jam, which I'm going to fade out now because I've got the man back. And it was the same song. It was the exact same song. Let's welcome Torque back to the party. He can listen to what he missed later on the podcast.
Dude.
Was it something I said?
Sorry.
Too much Platinum Blonde talk off the top?
Too much Platinum Blonde talk. I apologize, man.
What happened there? Power outage?
I mean, they've had these terrible storms here. So I don't know. Things are fucking weird. They just disappear all of a sudden and stuff. So
my apologies.
I'm back.
Well, let's get to the important stuff then. I'm glad you're back. Let's get to something very important. So this happens to be the anniversary of when Mark Weisblatt dropped by 3 years ago today. So we could pay proper tribute to the late great Dave Bookman.
Ah, Bookie.
Now, I thought we were going to have some kind of a Bookie Day every May 30th.
I just signed a petition, man. I just signed a petition. It's online. Go sign the petition to have a Bookie Day because he's the spirit of radio and the spirit of Toronto.
Elaborate on that. Did you listen to CFNY?
Oh, man. Dave Bookman is a very important centerpiece of my life. When I was 12, my dad was at the Stratford Festival, and I got a job at the Stratford Tennis Club because I love playing tennis. I got a job washing the courts. And the assistant man or the manager there was a guy, an amazing guy named Bill White. And Bill was the coolest dude in Southwestern Ontario. And he had all of the music. You know, remember, people, this was before you could just turn on a tap and have music piss out of it like it doesn't matter. You had to work to find music. And then when you had music, you had to listen to it because you gave a damn. It wasn't just part of your algorithm. So he had all these mixtapes he changed my life. He introduced me to the Smiths, to Billy Bragg, to Elvis Costello, to The Clash, to De La Soul, to Derek May, to, I could go on and on and on and on. The Dave Clark Five. He was my musical teacher. He taught me about great music. And the tapes that he had, many of them had been sent to him by a guy called Dave Bookman, who lived in Toronto. And Dave could get the tapes because Dave could go to the record store. There was no record store that sold any of this in Stratford. So Dave would buy the records. And Dave also had a band called The Bookman with his brother. And I loved that record. So I didn't know Dave Bookman, but he existed as this kind of mythical person to me, that he was in Toronto and he was the coolest dude in Toronto. And if you knew Bookie, he'd send you music. Wow. And he had this band. So cut to, 20 years later or whatever, and stars are coming up. And in between that, CFNY had been a place that I went to continue to discover music. There was a show called London Calling on Sunday afternoon where I found a lot of my favorite music. Even by the late 80s, I'll be honest, CFNY was already playing a little too much, problem rock for me. But but I loved Sundays and I loved late nights. That's when the DJs were allowed to play whatever they wanted and the DJs would play amazing stuff. And I don't think Bookie was a DJ yet on CFNY in the late 80s. So when stars started to come up and Dave Bookman had become like one of the biggest DJs in Toronto, I was astonished that this guy from my past was basically doing the same thing that he always did, which was playing cool music for people. And we went in and met him, and Dave was one of those DJs that, like, when you went to see Dave, you felt special. You felt like you'd made it because Dave cared. Dave had done his research. Dave had listened to the record. Dave could talk to you about other records that it sounded like. He was a consummate broadcaster. He was a true champion of music, a true lover of music, and a mensch, just a lovely, relaxed, warm person who always made you feel like an old friend. And, you know, I think, I'm sure that you know this, Mike, part of being a great host is making people feel like they've been there before. It's like a good maitre d', you know what I mean? When you walk in the door, it's like, welcome. And Dave was that person. And I know that he existed in a lot of people's lives as someone who was a huge source of support and positivity and, you know, just kind of personified the great shit about Toronto, yeah. The fun of Toronto and the relaxation of Toronto. When Toronto is at its best, it's filled with really interesting, weird people doing really cool shit. And Dave was just the king of that. And it's really tragic that he died so young. He's a great loss. When Dave and Gord both died at the same time, that was pretty much it for me.
Well, we'll get back to Gord, but Bookie, I mean, I mean this sincerely, and as a guy who was a fan of listening to Bookie on the radio, he got a start, by the way, on Live in Toronto. He would call in to the when Kim Hughes was hosting.
No way.
This is like the start of Bookie on CFNY. So
I was in New York probably at that point, so I would have missed that.
Right, yeah. right. Your New York years. We'll get to that in a moment.
My New York years, yeah.
How do we replace Bookie? Is he irreplaceable? I don't think there's another Bookie coming up the ranks.
Some great DJs out there. There's some great DJs. Lana Gay is a great DJ, and Rita Duris is a great DJ. And there's
in Pittsburgh now.
She's in Philly now.
Philly, yeah.
But, you know, Talia Schlanger is a great DJ. Right. I'm amazed, actually, by the number of how many there continue to be, like, really good DJs. I just think that radio has taken less importance in people's lives, and it's less of a power. So maybe we're less aware of the good work people are doing, but I don't know, man. I think that that's the thing about Bookie is, yeah, he was exceptional, but he was also kind of like the standard of what everybody should be. And I know that Lana and Raina and Talia and lots of people learned from Dave and were mentored by Dave. And so I think we actually have a pretty good field of DJs around. It's just that we don't have a monoculture.
Right.
You know, we have a shattered, we don't have a culture.
It's fragmented.
We just have an algorithm. There is no more culture. Culture is just grounds to scream at each other now. Culture used to mean things that brought us together. Now it means things we yell at each other about on Twitter. So, you know, the internet has killed culture. The internet has killed politics. The internet has killed love and sex. The internet has killed the music industry. The internet has killed radio. The internet has killed conversation. The internet has killed us. And if we're smart, we'll turn it off.
But you can also leverage that for good, right? Like, you can't turn it off.
I guess so.
I mean, literally, we're chatting on Zoom here for a podcast.
Yeah, that's great. But at the very least, they got to turn the algorithm off. Because the algorithm is antithetical to everything human.
Right.
Life is not about constantly having your beliefs affirmed and constantly having your tastes reinforced and constantly living in a fucking bubble where everyone tells you you're right all the time and you can gang up on other people and yell at them. That is not life. That's grade 2. That's grade 7. Like, when you grow up, part of being a grown-up is being exposed to things that you may not immediately like, but that you might find eventually are something that you do like or that you care about or that opens your mind or changes your mind. The algorithm is designed to just isolate people and then sell them garbage. Once we figure out exactly what they want, just sell them more of that shit over and over and over and over again until they think there's nothing else. It was invented by sociopaths and it's run by sociopaths. And, like, what the world needs to do is imprison people like Mark Zuckerberg, not fucking buy their stuff. Like, if you show signs of being like Elon Musk, you should go to an island where you learn to love and leave us alone.
So if I'm following along here in Southwest Toronto here. So yes, so internet actually, because I think there's a lot of positive attributes to the internet.
The internet's one thing.
The algorithm,
right. is an invention that destroyed the internet. And if you think about the early days of the internet, it was a place that was quite idealistic and where you could go and discover stuff and be exposed to different things. It is, once the algorithm arrived, it became profitable. Once things become profitable, their main motivation to exist is to create more profit. Well, that's not where art lives. That's not where you're going to find a healthy cultural milieu. You're going to find a healthy culture in a place where people pay each other fairly for the work they do and where they are exposed to things that don't represent just a complete list of all their favorite fetishes. And the only person the algorithm benefits is ad companies. You know, Facebook is an ad company. Twitter's an ad company. Instagram's an ad company. If you're posting there, you're just working for free for an ad company. I do it all the time because they've built addiction into it, right? They studied heroin addiction. They studied porn addiction. They studied how people get addicted to gambling. And then they baked that into the algorithm. Now, if that's not a crime against humanity, I don't know what is. And like, we should reject those people, not embrace them.
Okay, so if the game is rigged and the only way you can't lose is if you don't play, like,
that's the trick thing, isn't it? It's like, how can the revolution happen if the only conversation is happening through the algorithm?
Right.
Right? It's like Gil Scott Heron said, the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Pepsi Cola. It will happen inside you. And it will be a soft revolution. It will be one that doesn't go anywhere. That's why I think ultimately, you know, I was talking to Shad about this recently. He was like, we need spiritual revolution. The politics, it's sad for me to say this, but over the last 2 years, I've lost all faith that the political process can change anything in the world. And until we all try to elicit a sense of togetherness within our own self and express that locally to our neighbors, to the people we see every day, to the people we run into in the world, I don't think anything's going to change. And it's hard work. Like, that's a lot. That's asking a lot. So it might not change. We might be screwed. But the only hope we have is actual love, not algorithmic love.
And a lot of that, though, in my humble opinion, is you can't be lazy. You have to be savvy. It's knowing, like, who are the people you can dial into directly and kind of bypass the algorithm, you know, your tastemakers and your bookies, essentially. Like, who are the bookies where, you know, they'll let you know the jams you should be listening to and the bands you've missed, but you should check out again and stuff, where it's not an algorithm. I've heard Strombo use this sometimes of his show. It's like, you know, I'm choosing this music. You mentioned Lana Gay. I think Lana Gay is a tremendous broadcaster. I used to hear her on CFNY. Now we hear her on Indie 88. Lana Gay is great. But Lana Gay, I don't believe, has any input into the songs that will play on her show.
She has very little choice in the matter. That's for sure.
This is all programmed into a machine. There's an automation element where it's like, these are the songs.
Well, they've done the market research, right? Like, we heard from a radio station in Vancouver recently. They started playlisting our song and they were like, well, it tested badly. Well, what they mean by that is they got 6 people in a focus group and asked them if they liked it. And 4 of them said no. So they stopped playing it. They didn't ask the actual listeners. They didn't ask the people who were listening to the radio station. They didn't like trust that they liked the song and they believed in the song. They did what you're supposed to do when you have a marketing degree, and that's go do some marketing research and then deliver a PowerPoint presentation to the dude who runs the station. And, you know, it's all just, it's make work projects.
So when this market research happens and they come back and say, oh no, we're better off to play Your Ex-Lover Is Dead Again for the 100,000th time.
Or more likely, we're better off to play Cage the Elephant for the 7 millionth time.
Right, yeah. But as opposed, and I've heard this from a lot of artists who come over and they're like, we're making our best music today, but everyone's going back to the hit from 1996 or whatever, because they'll play that one again. Like, if I hear Smashing Pumpkins 1979 one more time, right? Like, and it's a great jam, but they're, you know, you gotta, It's very narrow.
That was kind of always thus, you know, that I think has been a struggle for musicians, pop musicians, for a long time, is like, you are both lucky to have that one big song and unlucky to have that one big song, because it does define you and it does kind of set this moment in time when you were quote unquote big, and the rest of it is kind of the detritus around you being big. So it, you know,
double-edged sword.
Over the years, yeah, I think on balance, I would rather have that one big song than not have one, you know,
because you gotta then eat, you're just right? Fighting. Like,
You gotta eat. I mean, not that that song helps us to eat. Nothing helps us to eat anymore, because Spotify has steals our money every day.
So, okay, I'm calling the audible on the line of scrimmage, because typically there's a bit of a bio and we kind of walk through and then we get to this juicy stuff, but we're doing it right now because last week I had Martha and the Muffins here sitting at the table, okay? Martha Johnson and Mark Gain, Martha and the Muffins, those two anyway. And Mark wrote Echo Beach. And we were talking about, you know, I think Echo Beach, much like I think this of Your Ex-Lover Is Dead and other jams, we're going to get to this later, but I think that's a great fucking song. That might be one of the definitive Toronto songs, Echo Beach.
Amazing song. The ultimate CFNY song, that's for sure.
Right. No, absolutely. You we talked a lot about CFNY. Yeah.
No, it's a wicked song. I love that song.
Wicked song. But we talked about how, you know, they were very grateful to that song because it helped them buy a house in Toronto. Yeah. And it has been very lucrative through the years and stuff. But then we did talk about, you know, today, and they said they got a check, and I can't remember if it was Spotify or whatnot. I have to go back to the review of the tapes, but they got a check for 2 cents.
Yeah. We have a check for 1 cent on the wall of our studio that hangs on the wall of our studio.
Like, repeat that though. You have a check somewhere that somebody actually took the time to postmark and send you a check for one fucking penny.
For one penny. Well, you got to do your accounting, Mike. You know, you can't, you got to answer to the bosses. You got to send that check out.
Is that Spotify?
Yeah, I mean, that's Spotify. That's streaming.
We have
about 10 million to 12 million streams a month on various platforms. We make, I don't know, $7,000 from that. I mean, we're six people. Right. We have a rent to pay on a building. We have management. People don't understand. When you get a record deal, you're spending that money. Right. The label is lending you the money at 150% interest. That is what you spend every single penny, every record manufactured, every recording budget, every bus, we pay for it. We are just a shop and we pay for everything. So we can't pay ourselves anymore. I mean, since the pandemic started, we pay ourselves what I would call an honorarium. And there are other income streams. Fortunately for me, I've been doing these commissioning songs. I've been writing songs for people, right? I went on Twitter and I said, if you want a song, I'll write one for you. You get to keep it forever. It's yours. And it can be about whatever you want it to be about, including you. And it's been amazing. It's been an amazing response. If you want a song, if you're out there, go DM me on Twitter. My DMs are open and I'll write you a song. But I charge $1,000 for that. In order to make $1,000 on Spotify, I would need a song to stream 400,000 times. So what's the incentive for a musician to spend any time trying to succeed on that platform? You can find one person who'll pay you $1,000 or try and find 400,000 people who'll play your song once. That is how stupid their business model is. It is theft. And when they say they pay musicians, that's like me saying, coming to your studio there and stealing every piece of equipment you have and then leaving a quarter on the table and saying, well, I didn't take everything. I left that cannabis poster up on the wall. Right. Like, it's pure theft. I get it. If you want to stream, go for it. I'm glad you're here listening to our music. I'm thrilled. It's better than you not listening to our music. But don't kid yourself. The same way that going to H&M and buying fast fashion, the same way that going to Costco and buying cheap coffee, the same way, if you're paying nothing for something, someone's getting exploited in order for you to pay nothing for it. So make your choices, but I just think people should know that.
No, I'm glad
musicians are being strangled to death, and people who used to make a living are not making a living. And that's just the facts of the matter.
It sounds fucking gross, and I don't even know how you fix it. Like, it's like, at least, what do we do?
Well, part of it is the labels, right? And this is Spotify's thing all the time, is they say, don't blame us, blame the labels, because the labels did a deal with Spotify and with all the other streaming services that essentially says, you are not the radio. We are licensing this song like we would license it to a film or to an ad or to whatever. So you pay that part of what the label takes doesn't go to the artist. The labels are making more money than they've ever made in history. Yeah. Everyone's making more money than they've ever made, except the people producing the thing they sell. And this is not unintentional. And this is true in every single industry, man. This is end stage capitalism. I hope everyone's enjoying it. It's run by sociopaths. It's a Ponzi scheme. It is designed to fuck the little person and enrich the least important person along the chain the most. It's a sick, sociopathic system, and we're all in it. And what do? We take care of each other. We start buying from each other. Go to our website, buy from us, join our Patreon, patreon.com/yourstars, $5 a month. I DJ every weekend. You get exclusive tracks. We do Ask Me Anythings. You get a party when you come see us at the shows. You get free merch. You know, if you want to know where to buy coffee, go somewhere where you can find out who the farmer was. And yes, it's more expensive, and that means we have to buy less. But this thing of like constant growth, constant consumption, constant access to everything, it's not working out for us. It's not working out for us. And it's going to end anyway, because climate change is going to end it. So to me, this is an exciting time because it's an opportunity right now to make alliances with people in your community. I bet there's someone in your community who's a great carpenter or who makes really nice vegetables. And I bet you have something you could trade with them. And to me, that's the future. It's like us looking in each other's faces and deciding what we need and trying to provide it to each other and stop relying on pimps. It's just pimps. Pimps up. Hose down. That's capitalism. And I'm not playing it. I'm sick of it. You know, it bores me and it's mean.
Barclay warned me. He said, full value when Torque's on the program. I'm telling you, like, out of a fucking cannon. Okay, Torque. So, and again,
I'm feeling frisky today.
So. I love it. No, I love it. And a lot of these themes will return. Would you be okay if I did a little bio here where we kind of walk through. I got some like stars questions, and then we'll get back to the current day, and then we'll get back to that firebrand. I love it, honestly. that's my style. But here, just a little bit. In fact, I just want to let you know, I remember my class trip to the Young People's Theater. I remember distinctly. Oh. We all saw Jacob Tutu in the Meets the Hooded Fang, and I have no idea if you were the guy playing Jacob Tutu.
I might have been. What year did you go?
Okay, so I'm born in 74, and so I'll start there. It was primary school, so I mean, if that helps us out.
I did it the year I was 9.
Do you know what calendar year it was?
1982, maybe, or 81, something like that.
I feel like we're in the right ballpark. I was probably 84, maybe back to the Sesquies again. It's all about
1980. Well, Hadley Kay did it. And Karem Malicki Sanchez did it, and I did it, and I think a couple of other people did it too.
But this is your dad's influence, I'm guessing, and you're an actor, you know what?
Well, my mom was an actor too. Right. My brother Ben is an actor. My sister B is a stage manager. My wife's an actor. Yeah, I mean, that was my world. That's what I come from, is 100 years of theater, really. That was what I was raised on.
So how do you end up in New York? Is that so you could, do what all actors must do at some point, which is have a role on Law & Order?
Yes, I did eventually. But no, I ended up in New York using acting as an excuse. The reason that I ended up in New York was because me and Jimmy Shaw of Metric,
right.
We're hanging out in Toronto for a couple of years, listening to Steely Dan and plotting our takeover of the pop music world.
Right.
And Jimmy, Jimmy doesn't settle for anything less than the best. You know, like if you're hanging out with James, it's not good enough to have like a nice glass of wine. You have to have the best glass of wine. It's not good enough to have a, you know, find a good place to play baseball. You have to find the best place to play baseball. So Jimmy was like, this place, we can't do it here. This isn't good enough. We got to move to New York. So we came up with this excuse. I auditioned for theater school and Jimmy auditioned for Juilliard and we got in and we moved to New York and neither of us did anything at school. We never worked at all. We were fucking useless. We just jammed. We had this amazing apartment that Jimmy had found because Jimmy only finds the best.
Right.
It was three stories high. It was in Midtown and the top floor was separate from the rest of the building. So we could jam 24 hours a day. And we just played music from, you know, the time we got home from school at about 4 o'clock till 4 in the morning every single day for 4 years. And that's how we learned to write songs. And that's how we sort of became musicians, really. And Jimmy and I had a band. And then Chris Seligman joined and Chris Dumont, who I do Memphis with, joined. And then we all moved out to Williamsburg. And then Jimmy met Emily. And, you know, the rest is history. I couldn't compete.
So when Stars forms, is that back in Toronto? I guess because that's all
Stars forms in New York. Jimmy and Emily had gone back to Toronto and met Emily.
Okay,
and it was clear that he was now out of our band because he had met Emily, and so Sully and I were in a room together. We lived in Christopher Street in the Village, and we had one room that we shared. Like a bachelor apartment. And that's where Stars started. I was 97 and I was doing a play called Shopping and Fucking downtown in New York with Philip Seymour Hoffman and Justin Theroux. And wow. I did that for almost a year. And that was an amazing experience too. But like every night I would go home to write with Stars and Phil would say to me like, what the fuck are you doing, dude? That like, you're going to go do that Pet Shop Boys bullshit again? And then he'd be like, oh, I love my girlfriend. He was always making fun of me for being in a band. He thought it was really fruity, but he was an amazing human.
Well, he was my favorite. I think he might have been my favorite actor of all time when he passed away.
Yeah, he was easily, I don't know, one of the two or three greatest actors I've ever been on stage with, that's for sure. And a person who taught me so much and so many things and a total... What can I say about Phil? Phil was someone you could count on. And the fact that his life ended the way it did should make everyone understand what addiction really means. And, you know, Phil said to me once, don't ever do heroin, dude, because it's the best fucking thing in the world. And when he said that to me, he'd been clean for 7 years. You know, when I knew Phil, when I was working with Phil, he was 100% sober.
Right.
But he knew what, if you watch his career, if you look at his career, he often sought out roles that would allow him to reenact the taking of drugs, right? The play we did together was about a heroin addict. Before the Devil Knows You're Dead was about a cocaine addict. There was something in Phil that was in love with the idea of destroying himself. And it was so, so far away from who he was as a person and from the rest of him. Phil was a quarterback. Phil was a fucking jock. He was like a dude who was like on point, a responsible person, an honest person who showed up. And there was just this part of him that couldn't live. And it was devastating.
My condolences.
Yeah, thanks. It was brutal, man.
Have you seen Licorice Pizza?
I have, and I loved it. I thought it was so beautiful, and I loved Phil's son in it. Interestingly, and I think, you know, happily, he didn't remind me of Phil. You know, he has the same husky frame and stuff as Phil and the same joy.
Right.
And he's a great listener like Phil. Amy Adams said an amazing thing about Phil Hoffman. She said, when Philip looked at you, you felt seen. And that was like, that hit me like a million tons when I heard her say that, because that's my memory of Phil, is being on stage with him and him looking in my eyes and feeling so seen and heard by him. He was so focused on the person that he was listening to. And his son has that talent too, but he's just a gifted guy in his own right. And I thought Danielle was, Babyheim, what's her name?
She was fantastic.
Alanaheim. Was so incredible. Yes. She's a superstar. I love that band. Heim might be my favorite band presently operating.
All right.
They represent everything good about rock and roll. don't they? I mean, that's how you want your bands.
Okay, so at
kick-ass this... players, sisters,
right?
Killer pop songs. They're sweethearts. I got to hang out with them once. They're fucking hilarious. They're just the best. I love Heinz.
Speaking of sisters, I have not yet had Emily on the show, but Avery Haynes is an FOTM. So
Avery, yeah, I know Avery. She's
shout
great.
Out to siblings everywhere. Okay, but so many questions. But at this time, you know, your passion seems to be music, but you're still acting. Like at this point, is it still your plan to be an actor? Because we mentioned Law and Order. Like I went to your IMDb page. Like Sex and the City is on there. Like there's some.
Yeah, I didn't get any of those things until I was almost about to leave New York. I did a lot of theater work in New York, but I could not get arrested on TV. And I came up, I was so desperate that I called my agent. I was like, I can't fucking get a job on television. I'm going to change my name. I noticed that everybody who got a lot of work had three names, like Philip Seymour Hoffman and Robert Sean Leonard. I saw these guys. I was like, I'm going to change my name. I'm going to use my middle name. So I spent like $500 and I got all my headshots done again. It says Torquil John Campbell. And my agent was like, you really do need some help. Like, this is not going to work. This is a ridiculous plan. And I bet him $100 that I'd get a job on TV within a month of getting new headshots. And I got three.
Wow.
I got all those jobs within like 2 or 3 months. It was crazy. They were all a day, of course.
Sure.
But the Sex and the City one was with Alanis Morissette. So that was
wow.
Fun.
Okay.
Yeah. And she was, again, one of the nicest people I've ever met in my life. I remember being on set with her and thinking, if I wasn't poor and anonymous and short and ugly, I'd ask her on a date.
Then she'd write a song about you when it all goes badly. Yeah. So you got to be careful.
Yeah, no, but she was a sweetheart. She was so nice.
Okay, so any regrets, by the way, in hindsight that you named the band Stars? Like, I want to know how, because for SEO purposes, even for me doing my homework here, that's a shitty
name. You're
getting
all my best stories today, Mike. I'll tell you another story. Here's a story about that. In 1999, we finally got a record deal by sending cassette tapes in envelopes. We would find the address of the label on the back of the record that we liked, and we'd send them that. And eventually we got this guy in Detroit who had an indie label who was going to put it out. And he said to us, I want to put the record out, but I'd really like it if you change the name of the band. And I said, why? It's iconic. It's amazing. He said, well, have you heard of the internet? And I was like, kind of. Yeah, right. Vaguely. Right. And he's like, have you heard of Google? And I was like, no. What the fuck is Google? He's like, well, it's this thing where you go and you enter something into a box and then all the relevant information about that thing comes out on a page. And if you call yourself Stars, like no one will be able to find you. It'll just be astronomy sites and stuff. And I said to him, dude, no one is going to find out about bands by something called fucking Google. That is the stupidest idea I have ever heard. The way you find out about bands is by reading the Village Voice, you idiot. That's what I said to him.
You know,
so that was my prescience, again, my genius for understanding the future.
That's what I was wondering. And it's funny because when, you know, bands like Linkin Park were purposely misspelling the name.
Misspelling,
like,
yes.
Like Linkin,
people
right?
often ask, is it with a Z? I'm like, why would it be with a Z? You don't spell Stars with a Z.
Yes, I will say Stars is a tough band to Google.
It is.
That's for sure.
But that was sort of the point also. We intended not to be Stars. That was the joke.
See, sometimes you're too cool for school, right? Like that's.
Yeah, definitely. All the time. Too cool for school or wealth or success.
All right. Yeah. This album in 1999, this is, and we're not going to do this for all the albums, but the first one, we're just going to shout it out. Night Songs, right?
Yeah.
So could I play? Can I play something and then I'll bring it down and
sure.
We'll move on here. So
go for it.
Here, just let me play some Stars.
It's hard to remember days, mornings lost in a chronic haze. Breath is fast and the trains are slow. In the dark behind other people's eyes, and then they disappear. Words get lost in the atmosphere. The truth I'll tell the truth. 16 on a summer roof. You ask for the facts, well, I'll give you proof. Hot sun on skin, that crimson dress too thin. For winter of the woods, I touched it.
Torque, I'm digging it, buddy.
Yeah, I love that song. It's a great song. My radio.
Tell me how and when Amy enters your life.
That's not Amy, actually. That's a lady called Renee Chassan.
Okay.
The first record we were making was just me and Seligman, and Jimmy was helping us with it. And Emily sings on a couple of songs because we were all living together in Williamsburg. So Emily sings on two songs, maybe. Renee sings on one song, and our friend Kendall sings on one song, who puts music out under the name Mascot. And we actually just played that song in New York at Christmas with her after many years of not seeing her. So that it was a bunch of women that we had on that record because we had not yet met Amy. And then just before the record was about to come out, we met Amy, and Amy joined the band. And so Toxic Holiday, which is the last track on the album, was like the first Stars song with Amy on it.
So, okay, so Amy's, although there's a couple of appearances by Amy, she's not yet a member of Stars.
No, she joined and then she appeared. So it was like just before we had put out an EP without her, a couple of EPs, and then Night Songs was coming out and we had to go on tour. And so Evan joined, who we had known since we were kids, but Evan had been playing with, like, he was a horn player with Big Rude Jake and a bunch of bands, and he wanted to start writing songs. And he actually contacted us because Jimmy had played him our music, and he loved it, and he wanted to be in a pop band. So he called us and said, hey guys, I'd kind of like to be in a band with you. And we were like, great, please, anyone other than us two, please join the band. So he came up to New York for a few months and sort of joined the band and started hanging out. And then we were like, we have to have a woman singer. Emily did our first few gigs. The first Stars gigs were me and Chris and James and Emily. Okay. So it was like Metric and Stars, but it was called Stars. And those were gigs in New York that we did. But Emily and James had their own thing going, and they weren't going to do it permanently with us. So we had to find somebody. And Emily,
yes,
had been Amy's best friend in high school. So Emily said,
oh, hey, Etobicoke School of the Arts.
Etobicoke School of the Arts.
I'm almost there. Kevin. I can almost throw a rock and hit it from here. Yes.
Yeah, they had gone with Kevin to Etobicoke School of the Arts. So we were introduced to Amy through Emily. And, you know, the moment she opened her mouth and sang, I was like, I fell to my knees. She loves telling this story. I literally fell to my knees and was like, that's it. Thank you. Wow. Join our band. So there's a lot of fate involved in these things. You know, there really, really is. Like the fact that Kevin and Amy and Emily and me and Charlie and Evan were from two completely different ends of the city, right. And Jimmy, you know, was on our end of the city, and Chris, were all these people, and then we found each other, and like we were all connected somehow. It's quite weird.
Well, think about this, right? Like you're all from Toronto, and then you're in New York, and next thing you know, it you're in Montreal.
Yeah, Montreal. Yeah, well, Montreal we went to because of Murray Lightburn. From the Deers. I loved my friend Matt, who had grown up with me and Chris and Evan, had moved to Montreal to go to school, and he had gotten to know Murray Lightburn, and he was like, I know this dude who loves the Smiths as much as you do, and you guys have the same birthday, and he's got a band. You should listen to his band. So he gave me the tape of End of Hollywood Bedtime Story, and I completely fell in love with it. I was like, I can't believe this is actually happening in Canada, that someone's writing music like this. And that it's a black guy. Like it blew my mind that this guy was like a second generation Caribbean Canadian writing, you know, Serge Gainsbourg Morrissey music, right, in fucking NDG in like 1998. I was just like, who the fuck is this guy? He is, I have to meet this guy. So when Stars all got together, Evan and Amy weren't Americans. And so we couldn't stay in New York. And anyway, New York was dying. And we weren't, you know, we weren't in the scene. Like we were living with the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, but we didn't sound like the Yeah Yeah Yeahs. And right, we were trying to make Pet Shop Boys records. So we were like, this isn't our place. We need to leave. And I suggested Montreal because I had heard it was really cheap and that Murray was there. The Deers were there. Godspeed was there. It was like, I hear there's bands there. I hear people are doing things there. Right. And so we just came, you know, with nothing. And none of us had to have a job back then, man. You could pay $200 a month rent. It was insane.
Yeah.
Like it was completely insane.
What are the artists doing today?
I don't know. They're not here, man. you know, I mean, there's still some artists in Montreal, and of course there's a huge amount of Francophone artists, but that culture of like, get out of school and stick around and start a band, or move here and start a band.
See, it's funny.
You know, it's still cheaper than everywhere else, I guess, but my fervent prayer is, the answer to that question is, they're in Saskatoon, they're in Regina, they're in Fredericton, they're in, you know, Red Deer. They're not moving to these centers anymore because they have this machine that allows them to push their music out into the world from their bedroom.
Right.
And, you know, that's amazing. On the other hand, it also means there aren't going to be neighborhoods filled with them. And that's sad because that was an extraordinary time to be a part of, you know?
I mean, so many themes that you're speaking of, like, are consistent with the Martha and the Muffins discussion I had last week. It's actually kind of mind-blowing. But now I'm thinking of Chris Brown and Kate Fenner, who are living on Wolf Island, right? Like, it's like, you're right, they're just not in Toronto. They're on Wolf Island.
My sister went to high school with Chris Brown and Kate Fenner, right? So I knew about Chris Brown and Kate Fenner when I was, like, 11 years old. They were playing high school parties.
Right.
And Chris Cummins, you know Christopher Cummins? Amazing songwriter. An amazing writer. He was in there with all those people. So, yeah.
Okay.
It was quite a time.
Amazing. Now, I'm going into another jam because not only is it a fucking great jam and I want to hear about its origin story, but I got a fantastic question about it from a huge fan of yours. Okay. So,
okay,
you're going to hear some more Stars. All right, you ready for the question? I know you'll have the answer. You ready for this?
I'm ready.
Okay. By the way, we'll get back to that song. I think that's just fucking fantastic. But okay, Elephants and Stars. I wonder if you guys inspired the name of this guy's band. His name is Manfred, and he's got a band called Elephants and Stars. And I'm going to shout him out, not only because he's an FOTM, which means Friend of Toronto Mike, but he's going to do a gig in Hamilton with one of my favorite bands of all time, Lowest of the Low. So
shout out
to Elephants and Stars. Okay,
I'm going to go listen to his music.
Yeah, it's actually really good. And I know Ron Hawkins. Yeah. And it's funny because Ron Hawkins died yesterday, okay?
Yes.
But that's the other Ron Hawkins. My Ron Hawkins produced the Elephants and Stars album. So it's all
cool. I'll check it out for sure.
Check it out. In one of their many great songs, Ageless Beauty, they changed the count/time signature in the middle of the song from 4 to 6. I've always wondered why. Was that their call?
Me too.
Is that a producer? Also, just tell them I love them, LOL. So please, speak to us, Torque.
I love you too, Manfred. I have a bunch of dudes in the band here with me who fancy themselves quite fancy. Some of them have even gone to music colleges and learned theory. And they're fucking musos and they like to show off. Like, you know, we often have friendly fights about this. There are many times during the recording process or the writing process of a new record where I will say to them, hey guys, how about you send me a song that doesn't have a time signature change halfway through the third chorus that is impossible for me to fucking feel because it's really difficult to write over. Yeah, they're just very inventive musicians, you know? They're always looking for a way, especially Evan is always looking for a way to fuck with rhythm and to find another level on which to get you into the song. Like, I think what's cool about doing that stuff is that it comes as a surprise. Your body gets lulled into thinking that you're in a certain time signature and you're bopping along. And then if it hits right, it kind of knocks you back against the back of the chair, you know? And they're really good at that stuff. But yes, I mean, you know, You blame post-secondary education. That's why I don't know anything about music. That's the greatness of STARS, is like, you've asked actually the exact wrong person this question, because I don't even know chords. Now, I write songs on my own. I make records. I play music. I play the piano. But I have no idea what I'm playing. I know A, B, C, D, E, F, G. But that's it. Like, I know how to read music, individual notes, because I played trumpet and stuff.
Right.
But I learned how to play music by loving music. And they hate music because they understand it. And so their options are limitless. I only have one thing I can do. So I just keep doing it. And that's the tension of STARS.
Okay. Firstly, I know Elephant, Manfred, as he's also known, I guess his government name, Manfred. He's going to be very delighted with that answer. And before I forget, my dear friend, Rosie, the first, you know, couple of dozen episodes of Toronto Mic'd had a co-host, Rosie, who my friend from high school. And I just remembered that she is a massive STARS fan. So I just want to say,
Rosie,
STARS are on Toronto Mic'd. It happened. It only took 1,057 episodes. Okay.
That's all. That's it. That's not that many.
Hey, Ageless Beauty, what can you tell me about this song? Like the writing of Ageless Beauty, what was the response like? Was this a hit? Are there hits anymore? Please talk to me about Ageless Beauty. Because when I heard this on the radio, and I think it was CFNY actually, it was like, what the fuck is that? It's so gorgeous.
I think it was our first, you know, now when I say radio hit, I'm speaking moderately. No, we've never really had a radio hit. We're not a radio band. And that's despite the fact that I think we've written a bunch of great pop songs, but we produce things in a strange way that doesn't suit the radio. And this song is a perfect example of it. You know, this song reminds me a lot of a band that I loved a lot called the Drop 19s, who were a band who formed in high school in Boston in the early 90s. But there's a lot of bands around that time, Slow Dive, you know, Chapter House, Ride, bands that they now called shoegaze, I guess. But sure. To me, we're just pop post Smiths pop bands who My Bloody Valentine were a kind of grandfather of that. The distortion pedal can create this kind of haze over the music. And underneath that haze, you can write really, really poppy songs, but they have a kind of toughness to them because they have this grind in them. All the pedals are turned on and there's a lot of reverb on the vocals and you multi-track a lot of things. And we've always had that side of us. We've always been in love with noise. You know, we love Spiritualized. We love Dinosaur Jr. And we're mostly a pop band, but there's an element of noise in our music that I think has allowed us to have a little variety on the records that we otherwise wouldn't have. And Ageless Beauty is a song like that. I had nothing to do with writing it, frankly. It was Amy and the boys, but I think I came in and said to them, it has to like be fuzzy, you know? Like a lot of the stylistic things in STARS might not have happened if it weren't for the fact that we spent a lot of time listening to my records, all of us, you know?
Amazing.
And I think my major role in all of the group of people that I've made music with over the last 22 years is playing records for people. Kevin and I have that in common. Kevin Drew and I have that in common. We were both musically a lot less talented than the people around us, but we also had better ears. We loved music more and we loved sharing it. And Kevin learned a lot from music and I learned a lot from music and we loved sharing it.
So before I played this other moderate radio hit that we all love, maybe speak a little more about STARS and Broken Social Scene there, because you mentioned Kevin there. But like, it sounds like this was like one big blob, and then you had these like two factions of one blob, and there's a lot of swapping.
Well, the blob happened after STARS was formed, really. Like STARS was, Broken Social Scene opened for STARS, as did Metric, at Lee's Palace to like 40 people. We had already had a record deal. Neither of them had a record deal. And we had been living in the States and we'd gotten a little buzz going in the States. We'd been written about in Pitchfork, for example.
Right.
So, for a minute there, STARS was the big band, but then that didn't last very long. And Broken, yeah, I guess in 2002, we had moved back to Toronto. I had moved back to Toronto with my then wife, who I had just met. And James and Emily had, I can't remember whether they were in Toronto at that point or in New York, but they were going back and forth. They were around all the time. And I got introduced to Kevin by Jimmy. Kevin was 17 when I met him.
Wow.
He was a bar back. And it was like he was running the whole bar. He ran. He worked at Monarch. Remember that place? And it was like Kevin owned Monarch. But I asked what he did. And he was like, he's the bar back. Like, he washes the dishes. But right. He owned the place. Wow. And I just thought he was the most charming fucker I had ever met in my life. I completely fell in love with him immediately. And we had lots in common in terms of the music we liked. And then he introduced me to Champy, to Brendan, and to Whitey, to Andrew Whiteman, and to Jason, and to all those, and to Feisty, and all those incredible humans that I met sort of in the space of 1 year in 2001, 2002. And it was a real love affair. Everybody just, there was a period of 4 or 5 years where we just did just be with each other every moment we could be, and whatever happened, happened. You know, if people fell in love, they fell in love. If the band was formed, a band was formed. If it was a social scene, I guess.
Yeah. And, well, I was going to say, what an appropriate name for a band, because a scene. And no wonder Barclay had to write a book about this. I mean, we even, you know, and there, meanwhile, there's a Arcade Fire out of Montreal, and, you know, you can run down the list of bands in this country that are making great music in this era. Like, you ever step back and go, yeah, we were a part of that scene. Like, we were there. Like, that's awesome.
I do. I'm very proud. Well, not proud. I feel lucky that I had that. And I wish I could remember more of it, frankly. So I was pretty fucked up all the time.
What were you fucked up on though? Is this cannabis? What is this?
Mostly cannabis. Yes. And white wine. But whatever, you know, even if it wasn't drugs, I was fucked up on love or fame or poverty or whatever.
Right.
I was just a crazy person. And so I don't remember huge swaths of it. But it's also because it's a continuous moment. It hasn't ended for us, right? Like, I still love those people, and they're still my closest friends, and we're still making records, and we still have stupid arguments. And, and, you know, like, it's still my life, you know? I'm not dead yet.
No, I mean, we got to get to the new stuff, but there's you happen to be the stars have recorded one of my very favorite songs of all time, okay? And there's no, like, qualifier on that, like, favorite Canadian song or, you know, no qualifier, like, just favorite songs of all time. So I've got to play some of it. In fact, I played this with Barclay when he was in my backyard the other day, and it was, we had a moment, like, we were just, like, soaking it in out under the sun. It was quite a moment for Michael and I, and... awesome. Maybe I'm going to revisit those memories now. I'm going to play it. You're going to tell me what you can about it. Then I have a bunch more questions. We got new music. There's so much we're going to do. But here is one of my favorite songs of all time.
When there's nothing left to burn, you have to set yourself on fire.
Thank you.
I don't actually want to fade it down, Torque. This is honestly, I'm just having a moment here. But
thanks, man.
Dude, congrats, man. Like, I can't believe I'm talking to a guy from Stars who created Your Ex-Lover Is Dead, which I legit think is amazing. How does it sound to you when you're listening in on this thing?
Sounds good. You know, it's funny, that song, because it is, has a life of its own. You know, it's a, it, the song is bigger than the band in a way. And it was almost immediately bigger than the band. Like, we didn't think of it as a single. We weren't aware that it was the song on the record that would change our lives. We thought Ageless Beauty or Soft Revolution, or, you know, there was a bunch of songs, Reunion. It wasn't that song. And then we played it for Kevin, I guess. And Kevin said, this is it. This is the one. This has to open the record. And so we got my dad. That's my dad there at the beginning. Amy called up on the last day of mixing. She called me up and she said, if you want your dad to say something, you have to come up with him for something, come up with something for him to say right now. Like, we're mastering the record. So what is it? And I was like, tell him to say, when there's nothing left to burn, you have to set yourself on fire.
Wow.
So she called up my dad and he said it over the phone to her. I had been writing Set Yourself on Fire on my arm in pen for like 3 years. And I wasn't sure why. I just kept writing it. And so I knew that it was going to play some role in the record. But and yeah, that song just emerged quite easily in terms of the lyrics. I think it took me maybe 10 minutes to write those lyrics. That it was one of those songs where everything just... I had it, you know, I had God, That Was Strange to See You Again. And everything after that came naturally and easily. And I think that's part of why people like it. There's something very inevitable about the lyrics. It's a story that everyone can understand because everyone's experienced it, you know?
Well, okay, we talked earlier how you're getting fucked on streaming, getting paid for streaming, okay? That's awful. But, like, this song must be, licensed for TV shows and movies and such. Like, this must
be. It has been many, many times over the years. But, you know, oddly, like, I think it's a tough one, actually, to license because it's a story. It's hard to know when to cut in and out of it. Ageless Beauty and Take Me to the Riot have done actually better for us financially in terms of licensing. But this is a song, you know, that I know there are millions of people out there who have this song on a playlist and have never heard a single other song by us. And I love that. That's something I always aspired to, that the song exists in and of itself as this massive thing. You know, not a lot of people can tell you who wrote Video Killed the Radio Star, what the name of the band is.
I can.
You can, and I can, but not a lot of people they hear that song and they're like, oh, I love that song.
I think that's
Buggles
a cover.
That song,
yeah, but are you sure they wrote it? I know that's their hit.
Yes,
but
Trevor Horn. Trevor
so it's
Horn
not a cover then. That's not.
No,
a cover.
No, that's a Trevor Horn production, man. That is like essence of his greatness right there. That guy is a fucking genius.
I know it's the first song they ever played on MTV. That's
right.
There's a trivia question.
I have the album.
Somewhere.
It's a great album.
Amazing. Okay. Okay. Where do I go from here? My goodness. Okay. So the role of factor grants, and I don't want to set you off anything. Can you just give me a little, like, I'm trying to understand. So tell me how factor grants helped Stars.
Oh man. I mean, there's no Canadian music industry as it presently exists without factor. Everybody should understand that. It's an amazing program. People attack it for all kinds of reasons and it's not perfect and nothing is, but you know, name a great Canadian artist of the last 20 years who isn't Michael Bublé, The Weeknd, Justin Bieber, or Drake.
Right.
And that person would not have a career without the help of Factor. They've helped touring. They've helped recording. They've helped development. They've helped. That organization has given life to a marketplace where you have to drive sometimes 3 days to get to the next show. So for people who criticize government funding and say, oh, they should do it on their own, that's one thing to say in a place where there's 380 million people, or in England where there's a major city every 2 hours. In this country, in order to make any kind of connection across the country, you have got to drive a long, long way. And in between, Mike just opened up a jar of spaghetti for someone as I'm talking, by the way.
That's for Monica. Hi, Monica. Torque says hi.
Hi, Monica.
That's my official job around here, is to open up these pasta sauce.
I think it's psychological. I think Monica could have done it on her own. She just feels it's just like this thing now. It's a block. That's what I believe. Because my wife always gets me to open the pasta jar. I'm like, but you're stronger than me. Look at your arms. You're much stronger. So, Factor has just, you know, given us breathing room and also allowed us to go to the States 5 times and fuck up and not have people there. And, you know, that's the kind of steady support that labels should be giving, but are not giving and haven't given in years. And if we didn't have Factor, that kind of development support, a band like Land of Talk or a band like Winter Sleep or a band like, Hey Rosetta, right? All those bands employ people. They produce wealth in the community because they were invested in. In order to produce wealth in art, you have to invest in it. You can't just throw it at a wall and say, go ahead, climb. You have to actually help. And that's what corporate music industry seems to have forgotten, that if they want a healthy music industry, they have to develop artists, not just go on YouTube, find somebody they think they can make a quick buck off, and then put it out. That's not the way to develop a sustainable music industry.
Okay, let me ask you about a band, well, basically Canada's house band, The Tragically Hip.
Yeah.
Like, okay, so I know you're, maybe you step back and tell me, like, were you friendly with Gord Downie?
I mean, you could not be friendly with Gord Downie. He's a if you met Gord Downie, you were a friend of Gord Downie's. That's the way Gord rolled. And next time Gord saw you, he'd remember your name, no matter who you were. He knew our names and the name of every single member of our crew the second time we played with him. That's the kind of guy he was. And that's what he exemplified. He was a, talk about a champion for other people and for other musicians and for community. He walked the walk and he talked the talk, you know, he did it. That was who he was. And that's who all those gentlemen are. That's how they rolled. That's why they had that place in the history of music in this country that they did, because they taught us all how to behave, how to treat people, how to play a show, how to show up on time and do your fucking job and be kind and be passionate and give everything you have and watch the other bands and show them respect, show the staff who work the venue respect, show the audience respect. You know, he's just an incredible person, incredible teacher, and a really fun person to be with and to talk to and hang out with. He was curious about other people's lives. He made you feel important when you were with him. And it was... really, 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 really sucks that wonderful, beautiful dude had to leave so early. It's not fair. Not fair at all.
No, it's not.
He was the goods. He really was the goods. So, yeah, you know, The Hip wasn't a band I grew up listening to because I wasn't into that stuff until I was older. I was an English pop guy, you know, but the moment I saw Gord on stage, before I'd even met him, I was like, that's the most incredible fucking rock star I've ever seen. Like, he just never stopped. And then the first time I met him, we played a festival in Calgary, and he sat on the side of the stage and watched every single band. They were headlining it, and it was an all-Canadian day. And he sat on the side of the stage on a guitar case and watched every moment of every other band. And it was just like, who is this dude? This dude is a dude.
Was Sloan on that bill?
Maybe. I can't remember who the hell it was.
I saw Canada Day. I saw it at Molson Park in Barrie, but I saw a Canada Day show headlined by The Hip. And
I think Sloan, they did it a lot. I think it was Virgin. It was a V Fest, but I guarantee you The Hip were like, we'll headline it if you put all Canadian bands on it. I bet that's why they did it.
Oh, man. Amazing. That's amazing.
When we got there, there was a fence around their dressing room, like their trailer. And I can't remember who said to me, but somebody who knew them, I think it was Evan or somebody, was like, that fence will be down within 10 minutes of the guys arriving. And they arrived and they pulled up and I watched them. They got out of their van. They were kind of looking at the fence and they went into the trailer for like 5 minutes. And then they came out and started pulling the fence up.
Wow.
Not roadies. The band took the fence down. Because they didn't do fences. That's not how the Tragically Hip.
So if you see me looking to my left, it's not that my wife wants me to open any more jars. It's I've actually got a print of Gord Downie, the Chenny Wenjack Foundation. There's a print of Gord walking the secret path. And just as you talk about, you know, Gord, I look over and it's I can't believe he's gone, to be honest.
Yeah,
it's...
I think of him a lot, all the time. I think of him because I want to be like him. I want to remember. I have a t-shirt that says doing it for Gord that I wear when I really need to feel like being cheered up.
In Gord we trust. Okay.
Yeah, we're doing it for Gord. Gord was the spirit of what we're doing here. That is how good a man that was and how good a person and how important he was. We're doing it because he taught us how to do it and he told us it was important. Gord was the kind of person, dude. Gord came to a star show. He bought tickets for his whole family. Came to the show, didn't tell anybody, went home, wrote us an email the next day. We're like, I love you. Didn't want to impose.
Wow.
Gord Downie.
Amazing. And again, I would give you all the time in the world to tell Gord stories.
Yeah, I could go on and on. He's the best.
Somebody by the handle, How Soon Is Now? How Soon Is Now?
I like that.
It's a great handle there. And favorite venues for you to play in Toronto? Do you have a favorite Toronto venue to play?
I love the Danforth Music Hall. That's a good room. I love Lee's Palace. That's a really good room. I really like the Great Hall. That's a good room to play. Where else? Massey Hall's overrated. It's a great place to see a show, but not the best place to play one, in my opinion.
Interesting. But, okay.
there's some good rooms in Toronto, for sure.
Awesome.
Opera House is a good room.
Yeah. Well, you're an East End guy, right? East a young guy?
No, I grew up in I grew up on Brunswick Avenue.
Okay.
Below Bloor.
Okay. Yeah. So
like Kensington Market College in Brunswick.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah. Cool. The new album, I need to find out what sparked. This is from Capleton Hill.
From Capleton
Hill. Capleton. See, that's what you're hearing.
Yeah.
Tell me about the new album. And I do have a song. I have Patterns loaded up. But I want to hear about the album and then maybe set up this so we can hear a bit of
some
new
stars. Well,
we made
it during the last 2 years. So you all know what that was like. And From Capleton Hill refers to a place called North Hatley, Quebec, which is a place where my family have had a house for 120 years and where we recorded Set Yourself on Fire, wrote and recorded some of Set Yourself on Fire. And it's been a place that's been a gathering spot for stars and for my family all my life. It's the only real permanent home I've ever known. I've moved around a lot in my life,
but
that place has always been there. And it's become really important to the band as a place to be together. And so I think in the last 2 years, everything was wrenched away. Everyone had a sense of what they've lost and what they might not get back. And we wanted to make a record that came from a place where things hadn't changed, you know, and where the music could take you to something that felt familiar and something that felt like home and an acknowledgement that like even that will go. Because that's the cost of love, baby. Because you got to lose it.
And this is Last Gang Records. So tell me about Last Gang Records.
Last Gang, we've been making records with them for a couple of records now. They're run by some great people from Toronto, Chris Moncada. And actually, the head of it is Chris Taylor. And he's a whole other side of our story. I've known that guy. He used to sleep on our couch in Williamsburg when he was an up-and-coming lawyer. And he used to front a band called One. A reggae band that our friend was in that we used to go and laugh at a lot. So they're just local people who have been really supportive and really let us do our thing, been really, hands off and given us freedom to be the band that we are. Chris, who runs the label, is a real fan, I think, a genuine lover of this band. And the band's meant a lot to him in his life, I think, in terms of him and his wife memories that he has. So it's really nice to be there because he understands what this band is. He understands how it works on people, you know, and they're engaged with our legacy. That's what they don't want to just like try and make one record. They want to try and stay with us. So they're great. We love him.
And before I play a little Patterns and then find out about the tour, what can you say about this song, Patterns?
Again, nothing to do with this song. I love it. Amy wrote the lyrics for this song. I think it's about friendship. I mean, when I heard it, I heard it as a letter to me. I think a lot of the lyrics on this record actually, in a way, are sort of letters to me from Amy, or letters from me to Amy, because we weren't together a lot. And I was, I lost it, dude, in the middle of the pandemic, from sort of November 2020 to March 2021. That was as depressed as I've ever been in my life, And I really lost hope for a while there. And I think a lot of what Amy's trying to do in the lyrics of this record are cheer me up and give me strength. But I think it extends to the rest of her friends. Amy's very engaged with her friends. She's very, very, very serious about friendship.
So here's what we're going to do, because I know you got a heart out here. You got other things to do. This is a very busy time in your life. So I'm actually going to play the song, and then I'll do the extra without you. So before I start playing, since we'll say goodbye now, and it's been amazing. You gave me so much time.
It's
you probably didn't
have. It's
been
a real pleasure, Mike. Thank you so much. No, anytime. Like, I love this. You're awesome. You know your facts. You want to talk. This is how I love to do it. Thank you. It's been an honor.
So on your way out, because you can just exit the Zoom, because I'm going to just play your music and talk, and then wind down. But do you want to tell people, like, for example, the tour, you're on tour, how people can support
you? Look at youarestars.com. We're on tour down the West Coast. The Vancouver show is sold out, but we're playing Victoria in July. We're playing Calgary in July. We're playing Niagara-on-the-Lake, Prince Edward County. We're going down to the States in September. We'll be doing some shows in December near you, Toronto, and near you, Montreal, and near you, other people, New York, Boston. We're going to Europe in February. Just go to youarestars.com or join us on patreon.com/youarestars. And we are in touch. Or just write us, Stars Band Management. Like, you know, just write to us. We're people. We talk to people. We're not fancy. If you have a question for me, please get in touch. I'd be happy to answer it.
Torque, you're an FOTM now, buddy, and we'll be doing this again one day. But thanks for this.
Proud to be one.
You go
proud
do your thing. One. I'll take us home. But thank you so much, buddy. Mike. I loved this.
It's been a pleasure. I loved it too. And we'll see you soon, I hope. Be well.
We went swimming. I was drowning. You caught my eye. I could tell you couldn't catch your breath. Change the rules and bury that cross for good.
The new Star album is called From Capleton Hill. It's available now. Get it. Support these guys. They're awesome. They're getting fucked by the streaming companies. Buy a t-shirt. Buy a ticket to the concert. Join their Patreon. Support stars. Loved my chat with Torque. And that brings us to the end of our 1057th show. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm at Toronto Mike. Torque is at Torquil Campbell. You can follow Stars on Twitter. Let's get the right handle here. You are Stars at You Are Stars. Our friends at Great Lakes Brewery are at Great Lakes Beer. Palma Pasta is at Palma Pasta. Sticker U is at Sticker U. Doer, they're at Doer Performance, D-U-E-R. The promo code is TMDS. Ridley Funeral Home are at Ridley FH, and Canna Cabana are at Canna Cabana _. See you all. Tomorrow, when we have a doubleheader, Mike Hannafin in the afternoon, and then Stoner Jams outside in the backyard with Andy from Canna Cabana and Stu Stone, and maybe some Canada Kev, some Kareem. It's going to be awesome. See you then.
Dodge is the best that I can.